are listening to show number 297 with Robert Morningsky, doing his lecture series on the Star Elders. This particular show being recorded back on August 2nd of 1996.
My name is Robert Morningsky. I am a full-blooded Native American. I am half Hopi and half Apache. I am by profession a dancer. I have produced several programs. I have had my own Native American dance troupe. I've had the good fortune to be able to perform at several theme parks, Disneyland, Knott's Berry Farm. I have been able to tour the United States and gone down to New Zealand, Australia. I've been into Mexico. And I've actually spent most of my life being able to perform the dances and tell the stories and share some of the culture of my people with audiences, as I said, throughout the United States and in other countries. So I am by profession a dancer. However, what we spoke about last night and what we will continue this evening is something that some people may find disturbing, but I think it is something that the response to, by the general public has been so supportive that we want to at least present the material. Whether one chooses to accept it or reject it, we are very comfortable with your choice and your decision. It is your choice. It is your life, and so we respect that. However, 30 years of research have led us to some very, very astonishing conclusions. And when I say we, I include my family and brothers and sisters that I grew up with. We have spent a great deal of time researching what in the beginning was a project in attempting to find the world's oldest religion. When I attended college with some of my brothers and sisters, I think as most individuals who are suddenly immersed in the college and university scene, one of the first things that occurs is that you end up challenging all of your beliefs. You are actually asked to question your faith, your political positions, your upbringing, your culture. And for many individuals, it's a shock to be put in a forum where some of the most radical ideas are presented and then some of the most conservative. And I was no different than probably most of you who attended college, in that I was surprised. Here was a place where some of the most outrageous thoughts could be entertained. And for me, it simply amounted to challenging and questioning the myths, the legends, the ways of life, the disciplines of the warrior, the upbringing that one has in Native America. Last night, I talked a little bit more in depth about my background and my history, and at this point, my apologies, but time is not going to permit a review, save to say that I will very briefly let you know that my grandfather and five of his friends, while on a vision quest in 1947, in August of 1947, almost exactly 1 month after the crash in Roswell, my grandfather and his friends witnessed the fall of a disc and arrived on scene prior to the soldiers coming to inspect and take away the debris. And they recovered an extraterrestrial. They found a survivor. Rather than leave him behind in the wreckage, they were able to carry him away and nursed him back to health in their hidden camp. After a few months, there was an actual exchange. There was a communication between the being, who they began to refer to as the Star Elder, and the exchange was actually two-way. A star being who wanted to know what it was like to be a warrior, to be a member of this world and this planet. And for my grandfather and his friends, it was the enlightenment, the education as to what it was to be a warrior from the stars. And so there was a two-way exchange. And after the star being departed, my grandfather and his friends, as they were raising their children and their grandchildren, they shared the stories that the star being had brought. And I grew up with these stories. I never once questioned them. I had no difficulty because, as most of you know, the cosmologies, the ways of life of Native Americans in general, speaks very strongly and very loudly about the existence of star beings, particularly in the Southwest. If one examines the Hopi Kachinas, wooden carvings which represent not the gods, as many people think, but in fact represent the powers that be, the spirits of nature, the spirits of earth and wind and snow, and the spirits of all things we refer to as Kachinas. And many of the beings, many of the carvings that you will see in the Southwest of the Kachinas, if one examines them, it's not a great leap in imagination to actually be able to see a star being. The myths and legends talk about star people who descended to planet Earth to teach the Apache and the Hopi, the Navajo, their ways of life. We have figures such as Nangasahu, the chasing star Kachina. We have Sohu. We have Hilili. There are numerous Kachinas who, in fact, personify. They're the manifestation of star people. So Native Americans in general have no difficulty with the concept of extraterrestrial beings, of extraterrestrial craft. We refer to them as dancing lights or lights that spin and twirl in the sky. We refer to them oftentimes as spirit dancers, lights that dance in the heavens. And so part of our very existence on a day-to-day basis speaks about the relationship of human beings and star people. When I entered college, I had no difficulty beginning to examine some of these in the civilized world, and I use quotation marks around civilized. I had no difficulty in examining what they considered to be outrageous, which was UFOs, extraterrestrials, star beings, star people, life on other planets. That posed me no difficulty. In order to pursue for myself what was true, what was real, what was life about, could my grandfather have been mistaken in his stories? Were the stories of this star being fictitious? Were they made up in order to entertain the children? I, as many other people, decided to pursue studies that would answer those questions that we're plagued with. What is life about? Why am I here? Is there truly a heaven? Is there truly a God? And I enrolled in a 3-year program, religious studies, and over the course of the 3 years did extensive research. And I found that every time I studied an ancient religion, that if I looked just a little bit further back into the past, I could find another religion which was even older. And it seemed as though the trail never ended. I was taken back into Egypt. I was taken back into Samaria, Babylonia, Mesopotamia. I was taken back to 4,000 and 5,000 B.C. I was forced to be able, at least on a very simple level, to examine hieroglyphs, cuneiforms, and begin to at least have a simple grasp of what their meaning was. Over the course of the 3 years, I put together a report which I submitted at the end of the program, and I entitled it The Terra Papers, The Hidden History of Planet Earth. I was very excited because I was able to document my findings. I was able to take sources from various cultures in the Middle East, even some from the Southwest, and I honestly believe that I had documented the existence of star beings in our past. Now, this was in the 60s, and of course, now we are familiar with the works of people like Zachariah Sitchin, Graham Hancock, Robert Bauvel, Robert Temple. There are numerous authors, and they have, particularly in the last 10 to 15 years, they have come up with this exactly the same conclusion, and they too can document what appears to be very, very heavy, very, very strong extraterrestrial influence. I highly recommend the Earth Chronicles series by Mr. Sitchin. I recommend Graham Hancock's work, Fingerprints of the Gods. If one examines what these authors were saying, if one examines the Terra Papers, which we have reprinted, we are now offering them to the readers and listeners. If one takes a look at the hidden history at these ancient societies affected by extraterrestrials, I believe that the first question that has to be answered is that if all of these authors, if all of the researchers are saying the same thing, that we were tampered with, we were touched by, we were influenced in some fashion by star beings, by extraterrestrials, the question we have to ask then, if that is true, where are they now? Where are the beings that Mr. Zachariah Sitchin writes about? Where are the beings who built the pyramids, who built the Sphinx, who created the lines at Nazca, and who created the Sun Gate at Tiwanaku, Machu Picchu, and all the structures in ancient China?